So, can you see my screen now?
Yes, thank you. Yes. Okay,
so then I start, right? Yeah, so thanks for the invitation. And yes, as Sylvia said already, this is a joint work between Alexander Schmeding and myself. And we were working on Lie theory for asymptotic symmetry groups in general relativity. And so the outline of this talk will be, first, I want to give more like a physical motivation for this investigation, in particular starting from special relativity and the Poincaré group. So the Poincaré group is the symmetry group of special relativity. And then I will discuss how this can be generalized to general relativity, because here a sensible symmetry group in the general case does not exist. But if you restrict to asymptotically flat space times, which I will define later, then you arrive at these so-called asymptotic symmetry groups. And most notably, these are the BMS and U groups, which stand for Bondi, Metzner, Sachs, which did kind of the pioneering work. And then later Newman and Unti proposed another group. And basically the difference lies in the definition of asymptotic flatness of the space-time, because this is quite a subtle subject. And just a brief motivation, I will go into this a bit more deeply later. So symmetries are very important in physics because of several reasons. One is, if you understand the symmetries of a system, then it's much easier to describe it. But maybe most prominently is Noether's theorem, which I will recall later, but basically which states that if you have conserved quantities in a physical system, then this is equivalent to symmetries in the mathematical description. So there's a one-to-one correspondence between symmetries in a mathematical description of a physical system and conserved quantities. Another motivation is that you want to understand general relativity as some kind of generalized gauge theory. Typically, a gauge theory is given via a principal bundle construction. And then the group of gauge transformations is, or sometimes also called the current group, then describes the gauge symmetries. This, as you might know, is not possible for general relativity, because here the gauge group, maybe in quotes, is the diffeomorphism group. And so there's no fiber bundle construction here. But if you relax some of these concepts, then you can understand general relativity as some kind of generalized gauge theory. And then this gauge group in general will be the diffeomorphism group or a subgroup thereof. And these subgroups are sensibly, with a sensible choice, are then these asymptotic symmetry groups, which we will come to. And finally, in this picture, it can help to understand quantum gravity better, or root to quantum gravity. As you might know, the two big theories in physics right now are quantum theory or quantum field theory and general relativity, and combining these two is a very fundamental open problem. And understanding these asymptotic symmetries groups can also help there, e.g. via soft scattering theorems or the like. So let's go more deeply into special relativity in the Poincaré group. So in special relativity, the space-time is given via a vector space, namely r to the 4, and then you equip it with a metric of the so-called Minkowski metric, which has a different signature for the time coordinate than for the space coordinate. And basically the reason for this is that a theory which has this metric is built such that the speed of light is constant in each frame. And then if you have this space-time, the isometry group of the space-time is the Poincaré group, which is defined as follows. So on the one hand side, we have the Lorentz group, which is just the orthogonal group with respect to this metric. And then the semi-direct product with this calligraphic T, which is the translation group. So basically, and in this case, it's rather obvious, this metric is preserved by translation in space-time, but also by rotations in space-time. So this translation group then will be replaced later when we pass to asymptotic symmetry groups by so-called super translation group, and this then will also become infinite dimensional. And just to explain this semi-direct product structure a little bit, so if we have a translation vector and a rotation element from the Lorentz group, then the product is defined as this. So we take the translation with respect to the first coordinate and then apply the rotation to the translation of the second coordinate, and then finally multiply the two rotation group elements. And if we take the matrix representation, then this is just matrix multiplication, or matrix vector multiplication, matrix multiplication. Right. So why are symmetries important? Well, there's this fundamental theorem by Noether, which has several, let's say, stages of complexity, but in classical physics, so the most simplest case is that space translation, so if you have a physical theory that is invariant under space translations, then this is equivalent to momentum conservation in the physical system. If you have a theory that is a rotational invariant, then this is equivalent to angular momentum conservation of the physical system. And finally, if you have a theory that is time translation invariant, then you have a physical theory that is, has energy conservation. And of course, in nature, we observe these three conservation laws, and thus we require, it is required that the mathematical description has these kind of symmetries. Another application of the Poincaré group is Wigner's particle classification. So the idea is elementary particles are point-like particles, and then you might wonder how you can classify them. And so the idea of Wigner was to classify elementary particles via irreducible representations of the Poincaré group. And so this works as follows. So the Poincaré group has two Casimir operators. So just for completeness, one is a momentum squared. Basically, this is a Laplacian operator. And the other is the Pauli-Lubansky vector squared, which is basically something like translation wedge rotation. So it has something to do with angular momentum, basically. So you can classify elementary particles by their form momentum, that is their energy and their momentum, and their spin. And this is really important in quantum field theory, because these are possible particle states. And if you go to general relativity, this is no longer possible. And so there's also one work which tried to do the same classification for the DMS group. So let's now pass to general relativity and asymptotically flat space times, which is kind of the next best thing you can get after relaxing Minkowski space. So in general relativity, a space time is given via a time-orientable Lorentzian manifold together with a Lorentzian metric. And in general, the isometry group, which is the first, basically the same as the Poincaré group for special relativity, is in general very complicated and very specific. And by this I mean, in general relativity, the metric tensor becomes a dynamic quantity. And so the isometry group then becomes a dynamic quantity. And you can see already that this is not a quite sensible group, because physical symmetries should be general in some sense. Also in general relativity, we have an action functional which describes the evolution of the metric tensor here. And the action functional is the so-called Einstein-Hilbert action functional, and it's given as follows. So here we have a prefactor with the Einstein gravitational coupling constant. This is just for dimensional reasons. Then we have the Ricci scalar and the Riemannian volume form with an additional factor of square root determinant of G, as usual. And then the symmetry group of such a space time, and also of this action functional here, is the diffeomorphism group, or more specifically the identity component of the diffeomorphism group. But this is also an infinite dimensional group, which is very large, and basically does not contain much of physical information, because it's just the symmetry group of this this framework, but it's not specific to a physical configuration.
May I ask something?
Sure.
So you haven't pronounced the words global and local, but the Lorentz group and Poincaré group are more related to global symmetries, and what you're talking about now is often referred to as local symmetries. Would you agree? So just to comment, because to say these on this page are not physically relevant as the other ones, which, so you want to get rid of this symmetry, kind of artificial symmetry here, or a redundant symmetry, a diff 0m, is that right? Whereas the other ones that you mentioned before are physically relevant, or would you disagree?
First answering the first question, which was about local and global symmetries. So it is true that the Poincaré group is a global symmetry in that it acts on all space-time points at the same time, which also reflects the fact that in special relativity, the space-time is given via a vector space, and any local symmetry would destroy this property. And here, diff M, just can do that, acting locally by rearranging maybe points locally. But I think typically the discussion about local and global symmetries is more relevant for gauge theories, where you have this principal bundle structure, and then you can either consider like constant sections in the principal bundle which act on the vector bundle of particle fields, or a local transformation group. So I think here the question of local and globalness, if you like, is more related to how you describe the space-time, but because on the one hand side it's a vector space, and on the other hand side it's manifold, which is much more flexible concept. But I think at the end, I think this local and global question is more relevant if you go to gauge theories and this principal bundle construction. And maybe this also partially answers your second question. Where you've asked for the physical relevance of this these symmetry groups. And I think this just reflects the fact that the space-time in special relativity as a vector space is a very rigid object, whereas a manifold is a very flexible object. And I think maybe the larger symmetry group is more like an artifact of this more general mathematical description.
Let me say one thing, David. You're looking at the symmetry group, why this in a way this full symmetry group is too large for physical insight. So you can basically shove every point to every other point in lots of ways. For at least let's say with the manifold is connected, and so it's more like a folklore fact that the symmetry group will not preserve any kind of geometric structure apart from the smooth structure of the manifold. So basically the symmetry group really is sort of just the invariant of the smooth underlying structure. But usually when you're talking about action functionals and so forth, you really want some geometric structure to be preserved by whatever sensible symmetry group you're prescribing for your physical theory. So can be seen as sort of an explanation of why this is too large for physical insight.
Yeah, but classically, for example, in string theory, you do have an action which is preserved by diffeomorphisms. I mean, you can build diff M invariant or covariant Lagrangians, but maybe that takes us too far. That was just out of curiosity. Thank you anyway for the comments.
Yes. Thanks for the question. And maybe as a final comment, the ancient Hilbert function is also invariant under the diffeomorphism group. So it is, in fact, the right symmetry group for either the space for the space-time as well as the action function. Maybe as Alexander summarized, it's a quite large group which is not specific to a physical system, let's say it like this. So now proceeding with general relativity, so this action functional is equivalent to the Einstein field equations, which read as follows. So on the left hand side we have the geometry part consisting of the Ricci tensor and there's a Ricci scalar missing, actually. We should have R here. The left-hand side, as I said, is covering the geometry with the Ricci tensor and the Ricci scalar and the metric. And on the right-hand side is the energy momentum tensor and the gravitational coupling constant for dimensional reasons. And so, typically in physical situations is actually that this energy momentum tensor is nearly compactly supported. And by that I mean that if you have a physical universe with a finite matter content, then this can only be finitely distributed, with maybe the exception of electromagnetic radiation going to infinity. But yeah, maybe let's start with the simple case where our energy momentum tensor is compactly supported. Then this means that also the Ricci curvature is compactly supported. And so, yeah, just to go back to the physical relevance, so this is situation is very common in physics, actually, because it models isolated stars or also complete universes which have a finite matter content. And so the original or historic reason why people have looked into this is to study gravitational waves. So this was actually also the motivation of Bondi, Metzner, and Sachs for defining asymptotically flat space times, but also the corresponding symmetry groups. And as I have said before, so the manifold is then Ricci flat, except this compactor where we have T mu. And so the, as you may know, the Riemann tensor here can be decomposed into the Weyl tensor, which is a conformal invariant, and the Ricci tensor. And so gravitational radiation corresponds to Weyl curvature, as it turns out. And so if the Ricci curvature is compactly reduced to a compact space in space-time, then and the gravitational radiation obeys this inverse square law, then also the Weyl curvature tends to zero when you go to infinity in quotes. So basically we have that, this is maybe a pedestrian way to define asymptotic flatness. So if you go like to infinity, then the metric tensor decays to the Minkowski metric tensor. And of course, was a very pedestrian way to describe this. And also the question is in which direction you go to infinity, because typically you want that this behavior for light-like or null curves. And also this induces different symmetry groups. But the definition we want to stick with is the geometric definition by Penrose. So Penrose called this an empty and asymptotic empty and flat spacetime. So if we have MG as an oriented and causal spacetime, and we have another manifold which has a null boundary, which is of this form, and this is very specific for four-dimensional spacetimes, that it has this form. And we have furthermore an embedding of the original spacetime into this larger spacetime with boundary, such that the manifold with boundary is basically the usual spacetime and the boundary. So basically what we end up with are these Penrose diagrams, where you have like your manifold and then you embed it so that it is here in the interior, and you fix like the spacetime at infinity. So this boundary here will then be the points at infinity, and you do this via a conformal inclusion. So going back to the mathematical definition, we have this embedding where we embed our spacetime M into this larger spacetime with boundary, where the boundary corresponds to the point at like infinity. And we have furthermore a smooth function, which has these properties. So it's non-vanishing here in the interior. It's vanishing on infinity, and its derivative at infinity is not zero. And so that the metrics relate as follows. So the metric in the inside, or the metric from the spacetime here is just given via this conformal rescaling of the metric of this manifold with boundary. Also, we need then that each null geodesic has two distinct endpoints. So this reflects the fact that our boundary is a null hypersurface. So basically, any geodesic will. So typically, when you draw these diagrams, then we have here the space axis and here the time axis. So this is basically time equals zero for some arbitrary reference point, and then a geodesic will start at time like minus infinity and then go to time like plus infinity, and it needs to hit these points once. And then if, so this is what is called an asymptotically simple spacetime. And additionally, if then the Ricci curvature decays at this boundary, which represents the point as infinity, if the Ricci tensor then additionally vanishes, it is called an asymptotically empty spacetime. So yeah, the Penrose definition is asymptotically empty and asymptotically simple. And both together is then called asymptotically flat. And now we come to the symmetry groups. So when we have an asymptotically flat spacetime, then a group is called an asymptotic symmetry group if the induced group on the unphysical spacetime, which is the manifold with boundary, induces an automorphism of this of these points at infinity. That is to say, in the definition of the Neumann-Unti setting, it means that this asymptotic symmetry group does only induce a conformal rescaling of the metric at infinity. And in the BMS setting, which is much more restrictive, it should furthermore preserve a strong conformal property. This is a bit more complicated, and so the big picture I want you to take home is that the definition of Penrose, just of asymptotic simple and emptiness, is just that we fix the points at infinity as the boundary of an unphysical space-time. And now Alexander will tell you more.
Yes, before you stop, sorry, may I ask another question?
Sure.
So what's the physical role of conformal transformations? How do you, because they do play a role here,
Yes, so
how do you interpret them?
This is a very good question. It turns out that the conformal group preserves the causal structure of a space-time, because the conformal group does rescale the metric, but it preserves the angles. And the angles for a space-time with respect to the Lorentzian metric induces its causal structure, because the angles decide whether a curve is like-like, whether it is space-like, or whether it is time-like.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, and so now Alexander will tell you more about these groups.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Unshare, I guess.
I can also try to just share, so you should be able to see my screen now, I guess. right?
Yes, I can see
go,
it.
Let's go just to full screen. Okay, so you might have wondered about why this part is divided into two parts. And so this is basically has something to do with, on one hand, the history of the problem and then sort of my own background. So David understands all of the physics stuff he was just talking about. I generally don't. So I'm more of a Lie theory guy. And the reason why I'm talking about this is basically, this is one of the oldest questions I had in any research statement I was writing. It goes back to my PhD grandfather, Karl-Hermann Neb, because he looked at this BMS group and said, I don't get what the physicists are doing here. They are claiming this is an infinite dimensional group. Is this a Lie group? And how is this constructed? And if you're looking into the old papers from the 70s, I guess, where Sachs, for example, was, or 60s even, where Sachs was doing this, I don't get it. But fortunately, physicists have found a better way using these conformal structures David was talking about to describe these groups. And then actually, at least structurally, it becomes very simple what these groups are. So let me just take you there. So in principle, what we can do now due to this Penrose formalism is we can disregard the whole space-time. We are only looking at boundary and conformal structures on the boundary. So that's the reason why a lot of copies of the two-sphere S2 and the reals will pop up, because if you remember how the boundary looked like, it's as a manifold, it's the reals times S2. Right, and so it turns out that these groups we are after can be identified with basically with symmetry groups on R times S2. And so first of all, we want to take a look at the Autochronos-Lorentz group. So this is basically the unit component of the Lorentz group, and there are several guises which we unfortunately all need. So there are some identifications. So on one hand, this Autochronos-Lorentz group can be identified with the conformal group of the two-sphere, preserving the standard conformal structure of the two-sphere, right? So this is the general result that this is, those are the Autochronos-Lorentz elements which can be identified with conformal mappings on the two-sphere. And then there's another guise, which is quite useful for what we want to be doing. So we can actually identify the two-sphere with the extended complex plane and think of elements in the conformal group or in the Autochronos-Lorentz group as Möbius transformations. So here we have the Möbius transformations as known from complex analysis, say. So and we can basically think of the elements as given by matrices. Yeah? So up to some identification, the Möbius group of all these Möbius transformations is a matrix Lie group, if you want. I mean, it's if you like classification of Lie groups, it can be identified, for example, with PSL2C. So there are also other guises of this one. So the important thing is that every Möbius transformation is basically given up to some identification by the four complex numbers, which satisfy the condition that the determinant of the associated 2x2 matrix is 1. And then, of course, there are something, so you have to identify these things under rescaling, something we will underhandedly do all the time, but I'm not going to talk about this. So the reason why I'm showing you these presentations is, I mean, the identification is here always happening with respect to the stereographic projection, where you map the sphere onto the extended complex plane, or if you want, the Riemannian mapping sphere. And the main issue is why I want this presentation as a Möbius transformation and or as a matrix to convince you that the next that this gives rise to a conformal factor K, which depends smoothly on sort of the stuff we are putting in from S2 and also on the Autochronos-Lorentz element. And basically this is the formula for the conformal factor. So, and we need that basically if F is an element in the Autochronos-Lorentz group, which has matrix presentation A zeta plus B divided by C zeta plus D, then this is the formula of how you cook up at a point Z the conformal factor. Right. And so to make sense of the Z is, of course, an element in in the two sphere, and I use the stereographic projection to map it onto the complex plane. So then it also makes sense to take here the usual norm or complex absolute value if you want. So otherwise, if I wouldn't use the kappa here, this would be one all the time. So the whole point is, why I'm showing you this is to convince you that we get a smooth and, if you want, and even analytic mapping in all of the entries we have here. And so this gives rise to a group action then. So the Autochronos-Lorentz group is acting on the smooth functions from the two sphere with values in the reals in this case, where we want to be building real manifolds. So we are looking at this function space, the infinity S2. And how is it acting? Well, basically you take an element, a smooth function on your two sphere, spits out a real number. You precompose it with your element in the Lorentz group, which we view as a conformal transformation of S2. And then we are multiplying with the inverse of the conformal factor. What I haven't told you here, so I mean, in essence, this conformal factor, because of the compactness of S2 and so forth, for every fixed f, this maps into some interval, some compact interval, which does not include zero. And this, so this is always a strictly positive number. So I can take the inverse, and we basically get a smooth action of the Autochronos-Lorentz group on the C infinity functions on S2. I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself because I haven't told you what the structure of this space here is. So C infinity function on S2, this is of course a vector space with the usual pointwise addition and scalar multiplication and so forth, but we also want to topologize it. So in the end, if you recall what David was telling you about the Poincaré group, the Poincaré group was a semi-direct product of the Lorentz group with the translations. And the idea here, how we will arrive at the first group we care about in this work, at the one-dimensional Sachs group, is just to look at this situation. So we have now the Autochronos-Lorentz group, and we let it act on smooth functions from S2 with values in the reals. And we think of these smooth functions as a replacement for this finite dimensional group of translations. And this is also the reason why the C infinity function in S2 are in the physical theory called super translations. Yeah, so they are basically allowing you to go. So if you remember, the boundary was a copy of the reals times S2. And so a super translation is picking for every point in S2, basically a translating number, which sends you in this copy of the real in some direction, either positive or negative directional states, right? And so we have that the BMS group is then, first of all, as a group, is just the semi-direct product of this vector space of the C infinity function or the super translations with the Autochronos-Lorentz group. And so this is now a very easy description of the BMS group if you compare it with the original works by Sachs, who is basically building the Lie algebra of the BMS group by asking for decay conditions on the vector fields. And so if you have this global picture here, then it's almost clear that this should be an infinite dimensional Lie group, but we're getting there. So one part of the semi-direct product is almost trivial because this is viewed here as an abelian group, right? So it's just a vector space. So this really is just abelian. And we have this with this action here of the Autochronos-Lorentz group. This is the BMS group. Okay, now the BMS group is actually the smaller of the two groups because it's more restrictive in what it wants to preserve. So this is actually the group which preserves the conformal structure on the boundary, which is mainly given by the standard conformal structure on S2. And the reasons why this should be the standard conformal structure and why the boundary should look like, as David explained, so with R times S2, this has physical reasons. So there's basically a recognition theorem which tells you that this is the right physical context for these asymptotically flat space-times.
Okay. Alexander?
Yes?
Would you mind commenting on in what sense C infinity S2 generalizes translation? So when you compose translations, you have a translation with a sum of the vectors along yep. translated. Or how does, so I suppose it uses the structure of this conformal group. How do you, how does this generate, in what sense are they, do they generalize translations?
Yeah, I think it's literally just like this, that in, so I mean, your boundary is R times S2, and really it's, well, you should think of them as being parametrized, I mean, parametrized by S2 elements of or numbers which sort of shove the R component around. So just, it's just, I mean, from the perspective of the boundary, which is R times S2, translation should really be just something which happens in the R component. And the conformal structure is on the S2 component, and the R component is, I forgot now what the physical interpretation of the R component is. Perhaps David can say something about this, but it's really just a translation in the reals, right? And I mean, probably we should have written here C infinity from S2 with values in the reals. So this is just, in principle, a flexible translation of the reals as a vector space.
Thank you.
Yes, so then maybe let me add also something. So this boundary R times S2, basically, as Alexander has mentioned, describes the points at infinity. And the idea of these BMS and Newman-Unti groups is that you want a group that non-trivially acts on the points at infinity by preserving the physical structure at infinity. And so the idea is in this Penrose construction also, which is a little bit involved, so I didn't have time to go into that very deeply. But basically, this S2 is meaning the points at infinity in each direction. And what you basically do is you move points on the boundary. So you move points at infinity. This is kind of the interpretation, the physical interpretation of the super translations.
Thank you very much. As you can see, this is sort of the teamwork part. Yeah, so where I can explain to you what the lead group structure is, and David can explain to you what this means physically. All right. So now we're going on to the second group. So we're actually and this is sort of where the Newman-Unti group diverges from the BMS group. So first of all, in the BMS group, we only took smooth functions on S2. The Newman-Unti group wants now smooth functions on the full, I mean, which depend on the full boundary on R times S2 and take again values in the reals. However, oh, sorry, this shouldn't be in display mode. So the other requirement above that it's a smooth function is that whenever I'm putting in an element of S2, so the partial function I get here should be an orientation preserving diffeomorphism of the reals. So this is again more or less like shoving the reals in one direction, but now I have sort of a flexible way of so it's not just translation by something, but indeed I can now pick an orientation preserving diffeomorphism of the real. And so this, there we also see that this idea that the BMS group is preserving something stronger by enforcing that it really is just a translation, I mean, abate one, which is parametrized by elements in S2, is now relaxed to it's a diffeomorphism, but it's parametrized by S2. So more probably one should say it's a family of diffeomorphisms. However, this group is immediately more interesting also already on the group level, because the group product is what you would expect from a composition of diffeomorphisms, right? I mean, mainly one should think of this N here, so this group, as a parametrized version of orientation preserving diffeomorphism. So they are carrying this parameter Z, but the composition is not really seeing the Z, except for that we are flipping or changing the elements with which we are parametrizing. Apart from this, this is really just the product in the diffeomorphism group. And of course, this is now non-abelian. Whereas in the BMS group, we had an abelian structure. We now get here a contribution which is not abelian. right? And again, we can let the autochronous Lorentz group act on N. And how does it do it? Well, on one hand, so we have here F, the partial map. And what one thing we see, we are again multiplying with the conform, with the inverse of the conformal factor. So this is as in the BMS case. Then we are applying our mapping F at the point where we have. So first of all, we apply our conformal transformation phi to the Z point. That's what's happening here. And as soon as we set this in, then F will be a diffeomorphism of the reals. However, we are not applying it directly to the number from the reals we have here. We are twisting this number. We are multiplying it first before we're inserting it into F, also with the conformal factor. Yeah. So this is now the and then one can easily compute that this really is a group action. And so the Neumann-Unti group is now the semi-direct product of the autochronous Lorentz group with this new group N here, right? And I mean, sort of the deeper reason, if you wouldn't include this conformal factor inside of the F here, then when you compute what happens, then you don't get a group action. Yeah, so you really need this to make the group action work. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. Okay, so the Neumann-Unti group is a group which is larger than the BMS group. So actually there's a canonical group monomorphism where we are taking an element of the BMS, which is given by this, the alpha is a smooth function on S2. The F is an element of the autochronous Lorentz group. The F just gets mapped to F. And we have to fashion from the element in the C infinity function S2, an element in the C infinity function on R times S2. So we have to say what should it do with the T component here. And so there is really just one way to go here, because we need a orientation preserving diffeomorphism. So we need to take T plus alpha of the Z. Yeah, so the alpha can only eat the Z. And then up to a translation, this is just the identity, right? And this gives you a group monomorphism. So if you're computing with the group products given by the tau and the sigma on the last page, it's an easy exercise to see that this really is preserving the group structure and compatible with the products. And so we can identify the BMS group with a subgroup of the Neumann-Unti group. Okay, so
So historically, I suppose the NU, I didn't quite get the names, group came later after the BMS. Motivation? Maybe you said it, but I missed that. Why the need to get to find this bigger?
Yeah, so this is part of an ongoing struggle in this whole field. I mean, we are today talking only about the BMS and the Neumann-Unti group. So far, there is no consensus in the field what is the right symmetry group for asymptotically flat spacetime. So the last 10 years saw at least the rise of, I think there were at least two or three more groups which also have the semi-direct product structure. And or sometimes they are not groups, sometimes they're only D-algebras, which are proposed to do this. So there is something called the generalized BMS. There is something called the, what was the other one? The extended BMS. All of these things are preserving different kinds of structures which have been identified as possibly being of interest on the boundary. And for the Neumann-Unti group, this is sort of the first, this was, as far as I understand, the first attempt to sort of create a group which is bigger than the BMS, which relaxes sort of the strong preservation conditions of the BMS a little bit better. I mean, the BMS has many good properties. So, for example, any four-dimensional Lie subgroup, subgroup of the BMS is already isomorphic and conjugated to the Poincaré group. Yeah, so this has historically been stated as why the BMS is a sensible, in a way, smallest model for the symmetry group here. So far all the other models people have come up with are bigger. Yeah, so this is sort of the gist here. However, let me now go sort of I'm already talking about Lie groups all the time.
Let me also shortly comment.
Yeah.
So the question on the correct asymptotic symmetry groups group is very much restricted by the very definition of asymptotic flatness of the spacetime, and this reflects the physical system you want to study. So, for example, as I've mentioned before, the easiest model obviously is when the energy momentum tensor is compactly supported, meaning that the Ricci curvature of the spacetime is compactly supported. But already as soon as you study, as you start to include electrodynamics, for example, which has this inverse square law, so maybe if you consider a star, then while its mass may be compactly supported, it is shining light to infinity. And so already in this situation, the energy momentum tensor is no longer compactly supported. And so you need to relax the definition of asymptotic flatness. And in this case already then the symmetry group you want, you need to study becomes much more general.
Thank you. Yeah, that's helpful.
Right. So now I want to topologize these spaces. And since we are function spaces, so for example, the super translation, they are on a compact space. So there is there's sort of the standard topology if you're coming from infinite dimensional function spaces. And this is the so-called compact open C infinity topology. It's basically we are inserting this thing using iterated tangent, or if you don't like tangent functors, you just say iterated differentials, into the continuous functions on the iterated tangent bundles. And you endow the right-hand side with the compact open topologies. So what this amounts to is that this compact open C infinity topology, what it allows you to do, it allows you to control a given function on a compact subset, and you can control the function up to finitely many of its derivatives. Yeah, so you can prescribe that maybe, you can, for example, prescribe growth conditions and so forth on the function and derivative. And this you can always do whenever you have here a manifold M and a manifold N. So with respect to this topology, both the supertranslation and the subgroup N become Fréchet spaces. The supertranslation become a Fréchet space, the N just a subspace of the Fréchet space. So the N is not a vector space, it's nonlinear. And you can just put the subspace topology on this. And if you do this, then the first result really is, if you're doing this, then both the BMS and the Neumann-Unti group become topological groups. And this embedding we had becomes a morphism of topological groups, right? However, so what I'll be getting at in the last minutes is, so really for the compact open C infinity topology, since this allows you only to control on compact sets, it makes a huge difference whether we are considering the super translations or a subset of the C infinity functions on R times S2. Because as soon as you have a domain manifold for smooth functions where the domain is non-compact, and unfortunately we are allowing here a copy of the reals, then the compact open C infinity topology is natural still, but it's not the function space topology you usually want to be looking at, because it can't control what these functions are doing if you're going out towards infinity. And that's a real problem. And we will see this also in the discussion of why these groups are Lie groups or not. For functions on non-compact domain, this is too coarse, and one has to refine it. But let me just, because I was talking about Lie groups before, let me tell you what I mean by infinite dimension Lie group. So a Lie group for me is a group together with a manifold structure turning the group operations into smooth maps, right? So manifold structure means the usual charts. We have an atlas and you're mapping this to some space. Usually in finite dimensional theory, you require that the space is a Euclidean finite dimensional vector space. We are relaxing this and say, well, okay, we can model our manifolds on arbitrary locally convex spaces, but then we have a problem. Then I need to explain to you, what do I mean by smooth? because beyond Banach spaces, so the usual calculus with Fréchet derivatives and so forth doesn't work anymore. So what I mean by smoothness is very briefly set down here. So I want that all iterated partial derivatives exist and glue back to give you continuous mappings. If you're familiar with the setting, this is the so-called Bastiani calculus. So instead of going to spaces of linear mappings and so forth, we are asking for iterated partial derivatives of all order to exist and be continuous. And this gives you a well-behaved calculus with a chain rule, so we can define manifolds, we can define infinite dimension Lie groups in the setting, everything's fine. However, there are lots of new phenomena. So for example, not all Lie algebras integrate to Lie groups. There are examples, I mean, this also happens already in the Hilbert case, and the Lie group exponential may be bad. So in principle, beyond Banach spaces, there's no ODE solution theory. And this is a problem. But so a part of the game with infinite dimensional Lie groups is often to show by hand that the ODEs you want for Lie theory can actually be solved. And one example, because it fits also nicely with what David was telling before, is diffeomorphism groups are an example for such an infinite dimensional Lie group. So if we endow them, let's say we start with a compact manifold. For non-compact, there's also a construction, but it's a bit more involved. We endow the C infinity functions from M to M for a compact manifold with a compact open topology. Look at diff M, then this becomes an open subset, and one can compute that for a compact manifold, the compact open topology turns this diff M here into an infinite dimensional Lie group. So this is the most popular example of these guys. Okay, and now let me just skip over the regularity because I'm running out of time. There's an important property called regularity, which basically means that you can solve some sort of differential equation that drives tools in Lie theory. Okay, so I'm not going, however, so the whole point, this was sort of the upshot of our first paper. If you endow the BMS group with the compact open C infinity topology, also the BMS group becomes a Lie group in this sense. So it's then modeled on a Fréchet space. However, it has some surprising properties which people who are familiar with finite dimension Lie groups would not expect probably. So it is not a real analytic Lie group. I haven't told you what analyticity means in the infinite dimension setting, so there's a well-behaved notion of that. However, you cannot complexify the BMS group to a complex Lie group, so it's a real Lie group, and it's nice in that way, but it's not a real analytic Lie group, so there's no complexification of this one. And it's a regular Lie group, and some formulae hold, so which is called the Trotter product formula and the commutator formula. These are usually of importance to representation theory. That's why people want to be looking at those. But I'm not explaining to you now what's happening there. So perhaps could I get 5 more minutes to extend the talk?
Because yes, yes.
So yes. I'm right. So this is basically what we have on the BMS group. So this is, to our knowledge, the first description of the BMS group as an infinite dimensional Lie group. This takes up a lot of work for physicists. Yeah? So this is built on all this semi-direct product structure and so forth. It topologizes the whole thing and looks at the the structure. And this, that is not a real analytic Lie group, is not very surprising if you know how the group structure is built and what you're doing there. So the argument is really not that hard to see that it's not real analytic. But I think, or at least our impression is that this is something which was surprising to physicists, because this also means that the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula does not give you a local model of the multiplication. And I think physicists really would have expected that this is true for the BMS group. Okay, anyway, so as I said, the Neumann-Unti group is too coarse to control functions on the compact open C infinity topology is too coarse to control functions on a non-compact domain. So, and in particular, it does not turn this part of the Neumann-Unti group, which we need to topologize, into a submanifold. So there seems to be no sensible way of turning this into a submanifold of the C infinity functions. And then we have a problem. If I want to build a Lie group, I need first a manifold structure. So the way out of this is to endow the C infinity functions with a finer topology. And there's a Whitney type topology, which is called the fine, very strong topology. And why is this called the fine, very strong topology? I'm not going to explain to you what this topology really does, because it's mildly painful to do that, but it has some properties which are of note. First of all, the C infinity function as a whole do not form a locally convex space with this topology, but they turn into a manifold. And the reason why they don't form a locally convex space is because the largest locally convex space which is contained in the C infinity functions is the space of all compactly supported C infinity functions, meaning that all.
Sorry, what type of space is the manifold? You say Bethe manifold. What type of space is
the manifold? It's a manifold modeled on a locally convex space. So it's not it cannot be modeled on a Fréchet space. So it's basically it's an inductive limit of Fréchet spaces. But so it's an ILF space, but it doesn't have any better properties than that. I mean, all of this is classical, yeah. So this goes back at least to the 70s, 80s when people have been studying these things. And however, this topology is extremely fine, and this is part a boon because it allows us to build a submanifold structure. So the N turns out to be a submanifold of this manifold in the topology. However, it is so fine that a lot of other stuff is breaking. So let me just use my last 2 minutes to tell you what's happening here. On one hand, the N becomes a submanifold, and you can compute that the group operations on the N, so this insertion or into each other, which is just a parameterized version of the diffeomorphism group, that this is smooth. So the N really becomes a Lie group. And then we can talk about, can we turn the semi-direct product, so the Neumann-Unti group, into a Lie group? And however, before we look at this, we have still our canonical embedding of the BMS group into the Neumann-Unti group. And the topology here, which is the correct one to turn it into a submanifold, is so fine that the image of the BMS in the Neumann-Unti group becomes isolated. So it has a discrete image. So every point gets isolated in its own connected component. Yeah? So this is basically because this topology is super fine. Yeah? So and the way the embedding is built. So this has discrete image, and this already tips you off that something is off, something's going on here, right? However, and it becomes even worse. So this canonical action we used to build the Neumann-Unti group becomes discontinuous. So we can prove, I mean, again, by an explicit example, which you can construct, that the autochronous Lorentz group does not act continuously on the N, so it cannot act differentiably on this manifold. Therefore, we cannot turn the Neumann-Unti group into a Lie group. Yeah, so this is the negative result, because in the compact open topology, we don't get a submanifold structure. There are intermediate topologies which also don't allow you to turn it into a manifold. With a fine topology, we can turn it into a manifold, but the group action becomes discontinuous. So we don't. So this is basically a negative result. There does not seem to be any natural Lie group structure on the full Neumann-Unti group. And this is now really a surprise. So I think physicists wouldn't have expected this. However, what you can do, and then I'm almost done with my slides, this action here is only discontinuous if you're going away from the connected component of the unit element in N. So if you restrict the autochronous Lorentz group to act on the unit component, then it becomes continuous and even smooth. And so the upshot is the unit component of the Neumann-Unti group is indeed an infinite dimensional Lie group in the fine, very strong topology. I mean, meaning that we are looking at N naught in the fine, very strong topology, whereas which cannot be expanded. So the rest of the Neumann-Unti group can be topologized. It becomes a manifold, but it doesn't become a Lie group because the group multiplication gets discontinuous. Again, and this is now easy to see, this group is not real analytic, so it doesn't admit a complexification. And it is regular, so which basically means that the Trotter and the commutator formula also hold for this group. Okay, and this is basically all I wanted to say today. Sorry that this took so long. So thanks for the attention. And here are the two preprints we have on archive from this year.
Thank you very much for this very nice joint talk. It was a very nicely organized duo. Thanks a lot. Are there questions? There have been a few, but more.
There's something in the chat I see here. Let's see. Okay, sorry. Sorry,
no, somebody just said. Okay. So I have.
Oh, yes. You can hear me, right? So yes. I'm not sure about my setup. Great. So I have two questions, actually, and there might be a dog doing some mischief in the background. I'm apologizing for that in advance. So first question is, when I'm thinking about asymptotically flat spacetimes, I'm always thinking also about the positive mass theorem and the ADM mass. Is this somehow showing up? Or are these groups relevant there? Did you see this object within your work or within the papers you looked at and so on?
David. Yes. Yeah. yes, there is indeed a relation. Yeah. Again, this. Actually. I mean, there are several definitions of masses in general relativity, right? Mm-hmm. The sensible ones are always related to some kind of asymptotically flat situation, yes.
But it's not known whether these groups that you have been studying say something interesting about this mass and so on. So there's no deeper relation, let's say.
This depends very much on what I mean. So there's this whole zoo of things, mm-hmm. also with the generalized and extended BMS. And a lot of the work, at least if I recall correctly, over the last, let's say, 5 to 10 years, is going in the direction like soft scattering, ADM mass, and so forth. And whether one should extend or shouldn't extend the BMS one way or another to account for these things. So this is and actually, as we've been talking a little bit with Glenn Barnich about these things, and so there seems to be no consensus whatsoever whether it's a good idea to extend it in a certain way. So depending on who you ask, they have a concept, and I mean, sort of in a way, the BMS is the smallest example and it's also the simplest one, and then you're extending it, and so for these other groups which may be more relevant for ADM mass, for example, we haven't looked into the Lie theory yet. So so in principle, we could extend the series of papers if we understood better what this generalized and extended BMS groups are.
Okay. Wow, thanks a lot. And my second question is, so you have found all these interesting things, for instance, that there is this missing analyticity of the Lie group structure, and that other groups are not Lie groups at all. So is there a physical implication of that? Does this cause some trouble to the physicist the structure that they may have been expecting is indeed not around?
Good question. Yeah, so I mean, one part actually, so what I didn't mention, so there's a connected issue which we weren't able to resolve right now. So for these infinite dimension Lie groups, there's, for example, in general, you don't have a good exponential map, right? So the Lie group exponential in finite dimensions is a diffeomorphism between a zero neighborhood and a unit neighborhood. And so for both for the BMS and for the Neumann-Unti group, it's unclear whether this would hold. This can still hold, though in a way, looking at it, I don't expect that it's true, especially not for the Neumann-Unti group, because this is sort of a version of the, it incorporates a parameterized version of the diffeomorphism group. So this is, I think this would be some, let's say, unexpected behavior for the physicists, because I think they would really like to use exponential coordinates here for these things. I mean, mostly what people are doing, they are working with the Lie algebra, and then a lot of things which are happening are that people are really looking into representations of these Lie algebras and try to classify representations. So one thing where this work might be relevant, though we haven't done it because I, for example, don't understand enough representation theory of to say anything sensible, is that you have the validity of this commutator and Trotter product formulas. Mm-hmm. Because this is, as far as I understand, Kalle-Hermann-Neep, this is really relevant if you want to do representation theory, let's say, of smooth representations for these groups. And so that you get this, that these formulas are valid should, in principle, if you're doing a little bit more advanced representation theory, should be of interest. Yes. Okay. So I think this would be the most concrete application I have in mind for these kinds of results. Right. I mean, beyond the mm-hmm. that it substantiates what you can already find in the earliest papers by Sachs, who's saying, well, this is an infinite dimensional group. But mm-hmm. since he doesn't have a concept of a Lie group and so forth, he's not really talking about Lie groups. And all the later papers are talking about these groups as being Lie groups in a certain sense, mm-hmm. right? Though none is doing this. Yeah? So, I mean, for them, infinite dimensional group basically means it's a group which is described by infinitely many parameters in a way that's mm-hmm. sort of the upshot.
Yeah.
I mean, on a lower level, so when you're going back to the BMS group, so wait a second, where we have the definition as a direct product. So here you have the super translations, which are the infinity functions, and this, in a lot of the earlier literature and also up to the 2010s, there are questions whether you really want C infinity functions here. Because physically it would be okay, at least for most of the things which should happen, to relax it to C2. Yeah, so to mm-hmm. To allow much more translations which are much rougher in the S2 component. And physically speaking, at least from what I've seen from the papers I've read, there was not a real reason why you should restrict to C infinity, though some people just do it out of convenience to not have to talk about differentiability in the issues here. However, if you want a Lie group structure on the BMS group, then you need C infinity functions. So then from a mathematical perspective, there is no doubt, as soon as you write some finite order of differentiability here, you still get a topological group, but it can't be a Lie group. Yeah, so this is sort of, at least if you're coming from the mathematics, this is deciding sort of this discussion: can we allow CK functions here? And from the mathematical perspective, not if you want a Lie group structure.
Well, that's interesting. Mm-hmm.
May I ask a question? So one of the questions has already been asked: how far you can identify Lie algebra and Lie group, because that's what physicists usually do. The other question, which you partially answered, or in great part, what about restricting to the unit component, which also goes in that direction? Maybe is that a strong restriction physically? What does that mean?
Yeah, so basically what the unit component means here is you're basically asking, basically the restriction is only happening for the Neumann-Unti group in this, so the N group needs to be restricted to the unit component. And this corresponds in the topology to asking, so you only want to consider functions which are, okay, depending on what your favor is, so you can say which are isotopic to the unit, if you write it down in formula, what this means you want all smooth functions on R times S2 because I think I have it in formula somewhere here, exactly, which coincide with the projection from R times S2 to R. The projection is the unit element with respect to this group structure, which just diverge from this projection outside inside of a compact set. So you can prescribe a compact set, and outside of this compact set, the element needs to be identical to the projection, right? So so this is basically the unit component in this topology. It means you can maximally on a compact set be not the identity to be still isotopic to the entity. That's sort of the point.
Yeah, so the unit component in the diffeomorphism group arises in Teichmüller theory, for example. That's the natural diffeomorphisms homotopic to the identity. But here it's not in the last formula you showed us, the one before. It's not as though you restricted, I don't remember now, the big F, the other formula where you had diff plus, where you would restrict diff plus to diff plus zero to
wait a second. Now I need to see which way. Yes, I mean that actually in a way this corresponds to, instead of writing like this, I could also say that the z here should take values. So if I'm deleting the t here. So I could also write this as f blank comma z should take values in diff plus zero. Yeah, that's
okay. Equivalent. So in that sense, it's natural. It's a natural thing to do. It's not. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
But so we haven't really considered the sort of the naturality of this. It's perhaps a good idea to look at what this physically means to do that. I mean, in a way. I was very happy when I had the product structures and I tried, okay, let's build Lie group structures. And I tried to prove that this canonical action is smooth. And then suddenly when I looked at my proof, I thought, okay, here something is going badly wrong. And then I found this counterexample, which is actually not very involved. Yeah. So one could have thought this right from the start that, I mean, it's a very natural function. You're just plugging it in and see that that you get something which makes stuff explode, and at least from the topology point of view. And so then simultaneously while I was doing this, my counterexample really uses that you're not in this unit component, right? So if you're in this unit component, everything goes well. And so the whole point then was, okay, we were a bit disappointed because obviously we wanted to turn the Neumann-Unti group into a Lie group. And then we went for the next best price so that the unit component at least is a Lie group, right? Indeed, it would be interesting to see what the physical implications of this are, or how this is connected to something sensible in physics.
Yeah, so in what I was thinking is in relation to Ebbin and Marsden's work and things like that, it's a natural thing to do, isn't it?
Yeah.
For people who look at the diffeomorphism group close angle, it's justified. So yes, it would be interesting to see on the physics side whether it's natural.
I mean,
maybe you also add that in general relativity, it is also very common to consider the unit component of the diffeomorphism group as the symmetry group. And the reason is that you also start from a certain space-time, and then you just want, usually you just consider infinitesimal transformations, it's a bit the natural thing to do when you start from a Lagrangian viewpoint.
Yeah, but infinitesimal means in the Lie algebra.
Yes.
That's why it is related, because you kind of identifying things locally onto a neighborhood of the identity.
Yes.
I mean, in a way, so sort of the diffeomorphism group of a non-compact manifold of, let's say, R or something, so people have been arguing how natural the Lie group structure on the full diffeomorphism group is anyway, on one hand, you cannot model the diffeomorphism group on all vector fields, right? So this is sort of also a folklore effect if you want. So there's and people really lots of people really hated that on a compact manifold you have all you model all diffeomorphisms on all vector fields. On the non-compact setting you model the diffeomorphism on the compactly supported vector fields, and one construction process is to first endow all the compactly supported diffeomorphism, or the one in the unit component, with a Lie group structure, meaning now that thing in the unit component being the ones which diverge maximally on a compact set from the identity. And then if you have this structure on the unit component, then you're just shoving it around. Yeah, by just proving that if you're, I mean, all of the components are isomorphic because the diffeomorphism group is a topological group. And so you basically transport your Lie group structure from the unit component to to all the other components by sort of translating, multiplying, translating back. So in a way, people have been arguing anyway whether for a non-compact manifold, the diffeomorphism group is a natural object, or whether one should restrict instead to the unit component anyway, because the rest of the diffeomorphism group seems to be a bit artificial. Depends now also, of course, on whom you're talking to, whether he or she is sharing this position.
So it's an endless conversation one could have around these objects when they involve the diffeomorphism group. It gets very tricky, doesn't it? Very involved. Any other question?
I have a quick question about something something else.
Okay.
The super translations, it seems that morally they ought to be related somehow to the stress tensor. Or is there some relation?
This is again for David, I guess.
Yes, I'm just thinking how to answer. So you mean like the super translations are related to the energy momentum stress tensor? I got this correct? Okay. So,
maybe just a yes, no answer. I don't know. Maybe I'm missing something.
I think the relation is when you have asymptotically flat space times, then this implies that the energy momentum tensor is in some sense concentrated maybe on a compact domain, compactly supported, or maybe if you relax this concept a bit, then it's maybe essentially compactly supported. And so the action of the super translations is really the action on the boundaries, so the points at infinity where the energy momentum tensor then needs to vanish. So basically when you start studying asymptotic symmetry groups, then you need asymptotic flat spacetimes, which means that the energy momentum tensor is concentrated in like the middle of the spacetime, and then you can consider the groups acting on the points at infinity. But obviously, so these groups need to preserve asymptotic flatness, and therefore also this compact supportedness of the energy momentum tensor, or relaxations thereof.
Okay, thanks.
Any other question? Well, thank you so much for your inspiring double talk.